Section 38 of The Golden Web by E. Phillips Oppenheim. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Book 2, Chapter 17. A Despairing Call. The great lawyer, whom the telephone message from Deane had summoned, sat in a comfortable easy chair adjoining Deane's writing table. His manner was serious, but not discouraging. "You see, Deane," he said, "after all, it depends very much upon this alleged document. The whole case practically hinges upon it. If the defendants are unable to procure it, or a copy of it, or witnesses who can swear to it, I do not think that they can do us much harm, especially if we take the course which I have already suggested to our counsel. As yet we have received no intimation that the other side have the slightest trace of the document in question. If, on the other hand, it should come into their possession, they are bound to notify us. May I ask, Mr. Deane, what you believe the probabilities are as regards this matter?" "It isn't a matter of probability," Deane answered. "To the best of my belief, there is no such document in existence." "In that case," the lawyer continued, "I think that you need have no further anxiety about the case. Of course, there is no chance of a long sentence for the defendant. You understand that?" "Perfectly," Deane answered. "I don't wish it. I should not have prosecuted him at all, but it seemed the only way to stop what might have grown into a serious annoyance." "I am sorry," the lawyer said, "that the whole thing seems to have been taken so seriously by the press and the public. I see your shares have dropped to a ridiculous amount." "A chance for someone to make money," Deane remarked. "I am much obliged to you for coming up, Hardaway." The lawyer nodded and took his departure. Deane sat for some time in a brown study. Fundamentally, he had all the direct impulses and propensities of a truthful man. The course of action into which he was at present driven was distasteful, almost repugnant to him. Yet, after all, he was only fighting Hefferman with his own weapons. The man was a blackmailer, nothing more or less. Yet the fact did not seem to Deane to make his hands the cleaner. And there was the girl. The memory of her face haunted him. Her desperate plight had been only too apparent. If that document of Sinclair's was worth the paper it was written on, it was he who was the supplanter, the thief, morally responsible for her grievous plight. He moved in his chair uneasily. It was almost a relief when the telephone bell at his elbow rang. "Is that Mr. Deane?" a woman's voice asked. "Yes," he answered. "Mr. Stirling Deane?" "Yes, what is it?" he asked quickly. There was a moment's silence. The terrified voice, which had still seemed somehow familiar to him, was silent. He could hear from the room to which the instrument was connected the musical chiming of a Swiss clock, the call of a bird, and then silence. His hand was upon the receiver to ring up the exchange when suddenly a cry of terror, a cry of shrill, agonized terror, rang in his ear. "Stirling! Mr. Deane! Stirling, come!" There was an abrupt cessation of that frantic cry. The last word was muffled, as though something had been dashed against the speaker's mouth. There was the sound of the falling of a chair or a heavy piece of furniture. Then silence. Silence ominous, heavy, maddening. Deane rang up the exchange. The young lady who answered him was a little annoyed at his vehemence. "I want you to tell me to whom I have been speaking," he exclaimed. "Where was I rung up from a few moments ago?" "No idea," the young lady answered tartly. "Didn't they give their name?" "I want to know where the call was from," Deane said. "Please tell me quickly." "We don't take any note of local calls," the young lady answered. "Ring off, please." "Stop," Deane cried. "Listen, please. This is important. I am Mr. Deane, Mr. Stirling Deane, of the Incorporated Gold Mines Association. I have just been rung up by a woman in distress, someone who appealed for help. She was dragged away from the telephone before she could tell me where she was speaking from. You must try and find out the number for me. You must do it. It may be a matter of life or death." There was an instant's silence, a buzzing noise, then a man's voice. "Sorry, sir," he said. "Our operator cannot remember the exact number that was speaking to you. It was a house in Red Lion Square, though. She is sure of that. How many subscribers have you have there? Deane asked swiftly. 24 or 25, sir, the man answered. Sorry we can't help you further. Deane left the office in such a hurry that a whole crop of fresh rumors was started. He drove as swiftly as his electric brougham could take him to the corner of Red Lion Square. All the time, with a telephone directory on his knee, he was copying out addresses. He entered Red Lion Square on foot with a paper in his hand. There were 28 addresses. He had no idea where to begin. 7 or 8 were the addresses of business firms. He struck these out. Then he tried others. One after the other he interviewed all sorts of people unsuccessfully. He was received everywhere with suspicion. Most of the houses were converted flats or cheap lodging houses. Half-dressed women leered at him over the banisters. Shabby men of all ages were slavishly anxious to earn a tip. Gradually, he was forced to realize that his was a mad, almost hopeless search. People stood at their doors and watched him, jeering. Women hung out of the windows, shouting coarse invitations or derisive comments upon his perseverance. His nerves were all on edge. His blood was hot with anger. Somewhere within a few hundred, or perhaps a few yards of him, this girl was in the hands of persons who meant ill to her. The terror in her voice was no ordinary fear. She was face to face with the worst that could happen. He reached the last house on his list. It was on the further side of the square, and one of the most respectable in appearance. Contrary to what was apparently the usual custom, the front door was closed and most of the blinds drawn. There was no sign of life about the place when he rang the bell. Yet, after scarcely a moment's delay, the door was thrown open, and a neatly dressed parlor maid answered his summons. Deane adopted new tactics. He drew a sovereign from his waistcoat pocket and held it between his fingers. "You are on the telephone, I believe," he said. "Number 0198. Someone rang me up from here about an hour or so ago. I recognized the voice, but the message was indistinct. Will you tell Miss Rowan that I am here?" The girl shook her head. "There's no one of that name living here, sir," she answered. "A rather pale young lady, tall and slim, who has just arrived," Deane persisted. "I'm anxious to find her quickly. Can't you help me?" He pulled out a handful of gold, and the girl looked at it with covetous eyes. She sighed as she once more shook her head. "There is no one here of that name, sir," she said. "No young lady at all, in fact." "You are quite sure?" Deane asked, with a sinking heart. "Quite, sir," the girl answered confidently. She made a movement as though to close the door. It is possible that Deane would have taken the hint and departed, but for the last searching look which he threw at her. He thrust his boot against the door and resumed his place on the inner side of the threshold. From there, he looked at her once more. He was right. There were traces of powder on her cheeks, and her eyebrows were certainly not natural. Underneath her trim black skirt, he caught a glimpse of brown open work stockings and tan shoes with a large bow and high heels. Instinctively, he felt that no ordinary servant would have been allowed to go about like this. "I should like to see your mistress before I go," Deane said firmly. "Please go and tell her. I will not detain her more than a few moments." "She's not in," the girl answered, with a distinct change of manner. "Please don't stay about here, or I shall get into trouble." "I am sorry," Deane answered, "but if she is not in, I'm going to wait for her." He was in the hall now, a miserable, untidy place, with a broken-down mirror and hat rack as sole furniture, and covered with a much soiled oilcloth. The stairs were right ahead of him, and Deane looked up. He looked into a woman's face as she leaned over the well of the banister, looking down. Almost immediately, she drew away and came down. Deane rose up to meet her. She was dressed in black, was very pale, with large earrings, pretty in a way, and certainly not a formidable appearance. "You wish to see me?" she asked, a little hesitatingly, as she reached the bottom stair. "I thought I heard you tell my servant that you wished to speak to her mistress." "You are right, madam," Deane answered. "I do wish to speak to you." "And what is it that you wish?" the lady asked. "An act of kindness," Deane answered, "for which I am willing to pay heavily. I am in search of a young lady who rang me up only an hour or so ago from this locality, I believe from this house. I am offering a reward of £200 for anyone who may help me in my search." He raised his voice. He meant the servant, or the person who was posing as a servant, to hear him. He was unable to observe her closely, but he noticed that she moved a little nearer and appeared to be listening intently. "I'm afraid you have come to the wrong house," the lady answered gently. "This is not a very nice neighborhood, I know, but we are quite respectable people here, and we are not upon the telephone at all."
"Not on the telephone at all?" Deane repeated. "But I have your name and number from the telephone company. Number 0198, Mrs. Gravis." "Mrs. Gravis has left," the lady declared. "I have taken the house, but the telephone was of no use to me, so I have had it taken away." "May I see the place where the instrument was?" Deane asked. "I have a particular reason for asking." "Certainly not," the lady answered a little sharply. "Open the door, Hilda. We have nothing else to say to you, sir." The maid obeyed, and Deane reluctantly took up his hat. He was already upon the threshold when he suddenly stopped. A remarkable change came over him. He stepped quickly back. The woman had gone as pale as death. From one of the rooms upstairs came the shrill, unmistakable summons of a telephone bell, and mingling with it, the chiming of a cuckoo clock. "Shut the door," Deane ordered sternly. "Madam," he said, turning toward the lady of the house, "it is still within your power to earn that £200. The woman looked at him curiously. £200, she said, "is a great deal of money. One does not carry about sums like that." Deane thrust his hand into his pocket and drew out a little roll of notes. "I have 12 10-pound notes here," he said, "and I can write a check for the balance. You know what I want. If you turn me away, I shall be back with a search warrant in less than half an hour." She held out her hand for the notes. "Follow me," she said. "You understand that I am simply a lodging housekeeper. I cannot be responsible for my tenants or their actions."
"I understand that," Deane answered eagerly. "Quick, lead the way upstairs." End of section 38.